Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. So it's our honor to invite Professor Patrick Tabeling from ESPCI Paris to give IAS distinct lectures on this microfluidics. And I noticed many students come from different departments and mechanical engineering, chemistry, physics, and even electrical engineering. So that, I talked to Professor Tabeling that this talk would be more general, so that all the student and student can understand about this topic. Before the talk, I give some brief introduction about Professor Patrick Tabeling. Actually, I did have some research project with Patrick Tabeling when I was a student at UCLA in 1999 to year 2000, and later on we have some friends Hong Kong research project. So I do enjoy this. Try to work with Professor Patrick Lab at ESPCI, and ESPCI is one of very small university, but very, very elite. They have about 7 Nobel laureates, and they really do very, very good research internationally, and so that I do enjoy to work with Professor Tabeling. And so Professor Tabeling got his PhD in University of Paris 6, and then later on he worked as a research scientist in ENS, another very good research institute in Paris. And then later on he became the director of research in this institute. And he spent about 1 year at UCLA in Professor Jimmy Ho's lab. And so that he gradually trained his research from turbulence, one of the very important in fluid mechanics, to microfluidics. And later on, he was invited by the former president of ESPCI to Professor Pierre Dejean to set up this kind of new research lab in microfluidics at ESPCI. And 7 years ago, actually, he set up another big research institute in Paris, founded by the Paris government, city government, and also this a very big research institute on microfluidics. And in the past many years, he's really spent a lot of research effort in this droplet-based microfluidics, and not only work on the basic research, but also work on some practical application of microfluidics. So I would see this field will become much more important in the near future for our healthcare. Okay. And I think without further ado, let's welcome Professor Patrick Tabeling to give a talk on this microfluidics.
Thank you, Professor Yiquan Li, and for organizing this visit. I am so happy to come. I've been here a couple of times, several times, collaborating with Professor Yiquan Li on micromixers, and it's always a pleasure to come over here. And I'm very impressed by this university and the professionalism and the creativity and the quality of the research. So I'm going to talk about microfluidic from general perspectives. In fact, 10 years ago, a review has been written and was published in Nature, and it was written by George Whiteside. George Whiteside is a chemist that is very impressive. He has founded companies. The value of these companies is something like $20 billion. He has invented some chemical reactions. And also he played a very important role in the development of microfluidics. He's professor of chemistry in Harvard, and he has very, very active groups. And in fact, he wrote a paper published in Nature, and in this paper, he tried to give an overview of microfluidics. And in particular, he said that at that time, the field is still at an early stage of development, that commercialization should be taken very seriously, and for further developments, we will need imagination and ingenuity. This paper has been cited 4,000 times. It's still very influential in the field. And since it has been written 10 years ago, it was interesting to try to know whether what was written was true, whether we are still in an early stage of development or in a mature stage of development, and whether we have taken commercialization seriously, and whether we still need imagination and ingenuity to make, to contribute or to make in such a way that the field continues to progress. And this is why I invite you to a quick tour in microfluidics. I would like to talk first about technology, microfluidic technology. In fact, for a long time, in the years 90, microfluidic has been dominated by silicon and glass technology. At that time, to make a system, a microfluidic system, we had to go to a clean room, use sophisticated equipment, and have developed some complicated techniques that need regulation and also a lot of chemistry constraint, and it was a lengthy process. And in fact, the domination of these materials was accepted. The reason was that, since you miniaturize a system, then you emphasize the role of the surface, and indeed the role of the surface chemistry. And since glass had a chemistry that was well-known and well-controlled, and since the goal of lab on a chip, microfluidic lab on a chip, was to make a chemical reaction on glass, a chemical reaction, then it was important to work with well-controlled surfaces. And this is why this drawing, this figure, that is quite famous. It was made by Caliper, one of the first startups in microfluidics. This figure tells you that the goal of microfluidic is precisely to miniaturize a number of processes that are currently made in biology, in biological laboratories, to reduce all that to a single chip. So all these operations that can be done here can be done on this lab on a chip. And you notice that this chip is made in glass. This was the dominant material at that time, and silicon as well. But in 2000, under the work of George Whiteside in particular, then another material came into play. It was PDMS, polydimethyl siloxane. This is a transparent polymer that is highly deformable. This is an elastomer. And from that time, then things changed because the microfabrication was much easier. You could even make a chip in your kitchen. So this attracted the interest of biological people, chemical people, that were interested in this field, but they were a bit reluctant to come into it because of this technological barrier. The technological barrier was more reduced and even collapsed, and then all this community got involved, interested in this field. This is a chip here, the PDMS chip. This coin shows that it is small, and you have the tubing that brings all sorts of fluid in the chip, and you have all this red line and green line that corresponds to microchannels, along which the fluids are driven to, in this particular case, to mix reactant, reagent, and detect a number of elements in particular samples. This was done by Quake, and this figure has been represented in the review of George Whiteside. So now, in microfluidics, we have a catalog, quite a rich catalog of materials and techniques. You have PDMS, glass silicone, but you also have plastic, photocurable glues, etc. But can we say that we are happy with that? Can we say that now there is no further technological development to work on? I think it's not the case. For instance, we know that 3D printing will certainly represent an opportunity for uh, microfluidics to make this technology more friendly. And because at the moment, when we want to make in a reproducible way a microfluidic system, indeed you can do that in your kitchen, but you have a good chance to have a low success, because it's preferable to go to a clean room or a cleaner environment. But with the 3D printing that are made now commercial product, then you can do that with a computer and this machine, and you don't have to go to a clean room. So the access to microfabrication will certainly be facilitated by the invention of 3D printing. So there will be certainly a change in the way how we microfabricate chips, microfluidic chips. Indeed, there are some limitations. For instance, the standard 3D printers are still low in resolutions, 20 micrometers, something like this. And also the surfaces that are produced by this technology are quite rough. This may generate a number of issues. But there is progress concerning the resolutions. Now we have, with the two-photon technique, a machine that is called a nanoscribe that is able to deliver a sub-micrometric resolution. But on the other hand, this equipment is quite slow. And also, we need a trained engineer to fix all the parameters so as it can work. So still, there are some limitations, but we may hope that in the future, this technology will take more and more space in the microfluidic community. I am not qualified to talk too much about that because my group is not working in these topics. But I would spend a little more time on a new material that has been invented, proposed, I would say, by George Whiteside, but that was not mentioned in the review made by him. This is paper. In fact, from the point of view of the development or the use of microfluidic technology in developing countries, PDMS or plastic, or PDMS, glass, and silicon more, are too expensive materials, too uneasy to find and to produce locally. Why paper is, from this perspective, from this point of view, very interesting. Paper, you have a sheet of paper here. Paper, as you know, is made out of wood. This is an accumulation into planar structure of a large number of wood fibers. And you dry it and you get a paper sheet. And you can, as you know, imbibe paper sheet by water, by fluid. And the fluid can flow through the paper. It goes through pores. Like this, it goes through pores, and the size of the pores are something like tens of micrometer. We really are in the realm of microfluidics, because these are the typical size of microfluidic chips. This means that we still take advantage of the physics of miniaturization. The physics of miniaturization for the microfluidic devices are first low Reynolds number, then you kill all hydrodynamic instabilities and you operate in a laminar regime, then the flow is very well controlled. And two, the small capillary numbers. This means that as soon as you have an interface, then capillary forces will become dominant. This is interesting. The third point is the large Peclet number. That means that when you transport something, the transport is dominated by the flow and not by diffusion. So here, all these conditions, all these virtues of the physics of miniaturization are already there in the paper. And moreover, indeed, when you use a sheet of paper, it's difficult to use it from a lab on a shift perspective, but precisely, it is possible to do that because it is possible to pattern the paper, and it is simple to do it. To make a chip, a device, on a paper sheet, Then you use a wax printer. You draw a drawing on the. So you design, for example, this tree. This is just a drawing made by the wax printer. Then you melt the wax. So the wax is melting and is going across the paper sheet. And then after cooling, you solidify the wax again, and then you form a physical barrier inside the paper across which the fluid cannot go. And for instance, in this tree, if you put a fluid on the roots, since the paper is hydrophilic, and let us say the fluid is a solution of fluorescein, then the solution of fluorescein will imbibe the paper, but it will be guided along the flanks of the flanks of the trunk. This is, for instance, an experiment made in the lab. So you put a drop of fluorescein solution, and it will be guided along the trunk and along the branches. So it looks very much like a lab on a chip, because this is what we are doing on a standard device by preparing or by creating channels. Since these observations, then people have tried to extend the possibilities, capabilities of paper, mimicking more and more standard devices. It is interesting to use paper because the paper is available in developing countries. As soon as you have woods, you have paper industries that can produce paper. You don't need pump because capillarity is doing the job. It is extremely cheap, less than 0.1 cents per sheet. And also, you avoid contamination by burning it. When you make test, it's interesting to avoid contamination. So all these advantages are appealing from the point of view of using paper to diagnose contagious diseases in developing countries like Africa. Now, paper is nonetheless a complex material because, in fact, when you drive a fluid through the pores of the paper, you first have an exposition of the fluid to air, and then it can evaporate. You have a filtering effect. For instance, if you have a blood drop that contains cells, that you know that contain cells, most of the paper won't travel with the fluid. They will be arrested, they will be filtered by the pores of the paper. So it's not a simple channel. There is also a filtering aspect. And also, the walls are made in glucose and in cellulose. And cellulose is not a neutral molecule. The structures here show that there are many hydroxyl groups, and these hydroxyl groups can develop hydrogen bonds with molecules that are included in the samples. This is a problem. This can be interesting from a chromatographic point of view, because cellulose may offer particular affinities with some content, some molecules that are included in the sample, and then you lead to develop a chromatographic effect. This is very well known in paper. But this underlines that paper may have a complex behavior. But when you have walls that include potentially reactive molecules, and when you perform complicated biologic operations, that you may get into trouble. Nevertheless, paper is compatible with many biotechnological processes. For instance, isothermal amplification. It is possible to amplify DNA on paper using isothermal amplification techniques. Isothermal amplification techniques is a rather new technique of amplification. In fact, in the past, we only had PCR, polymerase chain reaction, and this implied, in order to amplify DNA, you had to
heat up the sample up to 95 degrees. And this would raise, this raised a number of difficulties to use paper for that. But since a number of years, people are using more and more isothermal amplification. I won't go into detail, I'm not a specialist of that, but the main important point is that you still have an amplification, exponential amplification of DNA, DNA strands, DNA fragments, but you operate at 42 degrees for some amplification technique like recombinase, RPA. This is a particular technique that allows to amplify the DNA of a sample selectively, but working at 42 degrees. So this becomes compatible with the paper. And the experiment that we did is precisely that. We have a paper on which we pattern wells. So these are circular boundaries of wax that prevent the flow to the liquid to imbibe the paper completely. Then we bring the reagents mixture inside the well, the three wells or the four wells. We heat up at we freeze dry this the system. So in fact, the reagents are stored in the wells, and then we bring the sample, and they hydrate the reagents. They mix together, and then by keeping the temperature at 42 degrees, you can launch, you can quench, you can develop the amplification reaction. And this can be done on paper. And here, this is an example of what kind of result you obtain. We have synthetic Ebola RNA sequences. Indeed, we have a mixture of reagents that includes the possibility to convert RNA into cDNA and to amplify the cDNA. And when you introduce this sample on this well and you have a negative control, this means that you do not introduce any RNA sequences on that well, then you find that you can amplify the RNA on one well and you control that nothing happens in the other wells. So you got this typical curve where as a function of time, you have a fluorescent signal that increases in amplitude while the negative signal remains at the noise level. It is interesting to use this technique for the diagnostic of Ebola, for instance. In fact, we applied this approach in Guinea. You know that in 2015 or 14, there has been an outbreak of Ebola disease. And at the end of this outbreak, we had 11,000 dead people. And as you know, Ebola virus is a very violent disease. The virus is amplifying and give rise to hemorrhages. And the level of contamination is very high. And the problem at that time in Sierra Leone, in Guinea, and in Liberia, in Africa, was to detect the disease as soon as possible, so as to isolate the person that is infected, so as it does not contaminate other people. But at that time, the way of doing that, there were no clear technique of to make the diagnostic. You have standard technique, but it took time, and then it was difficult to use that for reducing the propagation of the disease. So the point now for this kind of situation is to use a technique that is not expensive and that can be deployed on the field. So, in fact, we use this amplification technique to diagnose the presence of Ebola virus on a real sample. In fact, on sample from which we have extracted RNA. It's easier to go to Guinea to find such samples rather than trying to find them in France, because it's so difficult to manipulate these samples. They are so dangerous that in France they are inaccessible, while in Guinea they are more accessible. So we went there and we used this technique to detect RNA in real samples. In fact, when you are infected by the Ebola virus, in the first few days, the virus particles are increasing in number. And you can reach levels of 100,000 virus particles in 1 milliliter. And then after 5 days, your immune response starts to develop, and then you synthesize antibodies. And if you are still alive, these antibodies are effective enough to reduce the number of virus particles, and then you recover from the disease. So if you apply the classical approach based on immunoassays, you have many immunoassays. For instance, a pregnancy test is an immunoassay. Then you have lost 5 days during which the person can contaminate other people. Why? If you detect the virus by performing a genomic technique, by using a genomic technique, then you can have an early detection of the disease. And this is why probably in the future we will come more and more to a genetic detection of diseases in developing world rather than remaining on classical techniques. So we did that in Guinea with Laura Magro, Béatrice Jacquelin from Pasteur, and this is the kind of results that we obtain. This is a negative sample. This is the positive control, negative control. Positive control, this is the blue plot, the blue, and the sample. And we checked that effectively this sample that has been declared before as positive was effectively found positive by our technique. So we study a lot. So in fact, in the future, we think that this kind of microfluidic technology, this is paper microfluidic, will develop for the diagnostic of contagious disease. In fact, the main issue is more commercial. There are startups, DFA, Diagnostic for All Startup, that has proposed a system based on paper technology for Ebola. But now, in fact, the problem is the commercial, the fact that to know whether companies find an interest in developing this test, but probably this kind of approach points towards the future. Let us talk about actuation and handling. At the moment, the most popular way of actuating and manipulating fluids in the microfluidic devices are based on PDMS valves. These PDMS valves are very simple. They have been invented by Steve Quack, and the principle is the following. Here you have a channel, a microchannel. You drive a fluid through the microchannel. But the microchannel is made in PDMS, and if the wall, that is the roof, is the wall that limits the boundary of the microchannel is thin enough, it can be taken as a membrane. And if you apply a pressure onto this membrane, it deflects, and then it can close the channel. So you make a valve. And this application of a pressure is made with another channel, microchannel, that is built on top of the first one. So this is a technique that has been invented, simple technique, been invented a long time ago. And Steve Quack has made a company that is called Fluidyme. Also he demonstrated that you can use thousands of valves on a ship to make complicated operations. And biologists have benefited from this technology because they could use they could make tests, many tests that were not possible to be made before. Okay, producing droplets is also another way of manipulating fluids. And this is an example. Droplets are small, and you can use them as a container, as a reactor. and perform many different reactions of the single ship. And now, so this was shown also in a famous paper a long time ago made by Ismagilov, where in a droplet you can introduce different reagents at different concentrations and screen the chemical reaction under different composition conditions. You can screen it in a small time because these droplets can be produced at a large frequency. Kilohertz is the standard value. So, are we satisfied with the available microfluidic actuators? In fact, not. For the following reason. First, the PDMS valves are still very expensive. If a lab wants to use this technology, they have to pay for $200 to have the technique. It's quite a bit complex, simple in principle, but in practice very expensive. On the other hand, the droplet-based technology, droplets are also quite expensive, but they are very limited. For instance, when you confine a chemical reaction in a droplet, it's very difficult to have access to it. If you want a reagent, to add a reagent, you can do that, but under certain conditions. So it's not easy. So we think that if the keys of microfluidics is to really manipulate in a sophisticated way and not in a cheap way fluid, then we have to make progress in this area. So we have worked on hydrogel actuators. In fact, you can make hydrogel actuators. We think that they are very interesting. So it is possible now to deposit a sort of patch of gel onto a glass plate. For instance, this is an example. This is a microscopic interferometric image where you can deposit a sort of a rectangle of gel, 3 micrometer high, 400 micrometer long, and 50 micrometer wide. So with this patch, if you can cover this patch by some material, for instance PDMS, in such a way you form a microchannel. And since the gel that is used is thermosensitive, by changing the temperature, you can swell it and expand it. Above 32 degrees, if you use polynipam, we know that the physicochemistry of polynipam at such temperature is such that the chains are hydrophobic, so they don't like water and they want to retract. So you form a layer of this gel. But if you decrease the temperature, the physicochemistry of the systems induce a transition from hydrophobic to hydrophilic. And then suddenly, the chains start loving water, and then they tend to swell. So this can be a valve. And with this valve, so this is an example of a valve. So here we have a bright field image of the gel patch that we have deposited in the channel. And from this bright field image, you note that in this case, the valve is closed, the hydrogen is swollen, while here it is open because the hydrogel barrier is collapsed. And you see that there is a change of gray level, the change of intensity from this image to that image, and we exploit this change of intensity to plot the topographic level, the topographic image of the gel barrier. So this is a case where at low temperature the gel is swollen, the valve is closed. When you increase the temperature, the gel collapses and then the valve is open. And this is a movie that shows how it works. It has been accelerated 8 times, and this is a real physical movie. This is not a fake movie nor a computational movie. This is a physical topography of the gel barriers that varies as you change the temperature. This is a valve. the valve quite can react quite fast. The typical time of reaction of the valve is 300 milliseconds, which is very well acceptable for biological application. You can also deposit gel under and make different topography or different structures. This is a case where we make many wells, and with the temperature, the well can be swollen, so the walls are raised up, and that can trap something. But as you increase the temperature, then the gel collapses and you open somehow the well. And for instance, this is an experiment where these are many wells that are labeled with rhodamine, because rhodamine, here you flow fluorescein, you collapse the barrier quite fast, you raise again the barrier, and then by washing again, you can isolate fluorescein in many wells. This can be done quite rapidly. And indeed, if you can isolate fluorescein in many barriers, this means that you can isolate cells, particles, particular molecules with this technology. We think that this technology is promising and it can represent an alternative to existing technology. Okay, let us talk about single cell. How much time? So it's okay. If you are able with the microfluidic technology to manipulate the fluids in an exquisite manner, this means that you can isolate cells and study individual cells. And the study of the single cells is a very important area in the field of microfluidics. In fact, a long time ago, this is a paper that was published in Science in 2002 by Michael Helowitz. It has a big impact in the domain because they took E. coli particle, I would say, E. coli, and then they, in fact, they were clones, so they had exactly the same genomes, but these objects, these entities, turn out in the same conditions to express genes differently. So some entities were expressing some genes, giving rise to a yellow color, others green colors and intermediate situations. So this demonstrated that this system, indeed it was known, we know that we have the same genome and the genome expresses different RNA that lead to the synthesis of different proteins. So the expression and the genetic and the genome are things that are completely different. But here in this case, these objects were exposed to the same physical conditions and they have the same genome. And despite of that, they were shown to express genes differently. Okay, this means that in a population of cells, you don't know a priori what individual cells are able to express. And this shows that there is a variability of expression, and this may have medical implications. But up to a few years ago, we were not able, I would say, except a little bit marginally, we were not able to take this population and analyze the cells, the genomic content, the transcriptomic content, one by one in a sufficiently large number to figure out results of statistical interest. But in fact, since a few years, technologies have progressed, and in particular, microfluidic technology have progressed, and those based on valves, quake valves, have proposed commercial systems that allows to from a sample to dissociate the cells, to dilute them in some liquid, in some buffer, and then to load this suspension of cell in a chip here. The chip is here. And in the chip includes a part that allows to isolate the cells. So you isolate the cell somewhere, you also lyse them, you perform the retrotranscription, you preamplify, and then you extract the cell from the chip and to perform more sophisticated analysis. So now this is possible. There are issues, there are technological issues that have been underlined recently and that led the companies, Fridheim, to decrease its value in the stock market by almost one order of magnitude. But there are issues, but still the technology proved to be available and many biologists have used that. I think probably up to a point where this has been considered as a method of the year in a publication made by Nature Method a few years ago. In fact, from the point of view of the biological research, this microfluidic technology brings many new data, new information that can be important to take to understand how a complex biological system is behaving. It's about the type of heterogeneity of within the same population of cells, also heterogeneity in the function, the role of the local environment that may generate also of an heterogeneity of expression in a cell population, for instance, in a biofilm. Probably, if you the cells that are very close to the wall behave differently as those that are exposed to the environment. But this is possible to analyze that now with the single cell technique. There are some aspects that are very interesting for biological research. So, in fact, microfluidic technology allows, in the domain of biological research, to open new areas. But also from a medical point of view, single cells is also a very important aspect to take into account, for instance, in cancer research. This is a case of a patient that has been that has a cancer and he has a melanoma with some mutation. I'm not a specialist of that. So this was his state before the starting of the treatment. The treatment was successful and after 15 days, he was almost he has almost killed his cancer. But the treatment has been continued for a number of weeks, and he got a recurrence of the cancer after 23 weeks of treatment. And what is important is that each places where you have this melanoma, you find that you have melanoma here, you again have melanoma here. So, in fact, the pattern of the melanoma here has been reproduced, has been retrieved 20 weeks after. This indicates that in the cancer treatment that has been used in this particular case, the treatment has succeeded to kill most of the cancer cells, but there are a few that had some different expression and that probably have some defenses against the treatment. That those cells have not been killed by the treatment and they could develop a new cancer, giving rise to this impressive picture. So, in fact, in the medicine of the future, you have to know that in the US, about most of the spending for curing the cancer are concerned with the recurrence of cancer. More than 50%. So this is a big problem. So if we want to fight the recurrence of cancer, then you have to, in principle, to take all the cancer cells, treat them individually in large number, and devise a special cocktail for killing all these cells and taking into account the huge diversity. So this is probably the medicine of the future, but at the moment, it takes a lot of money. The techniques are not exactly there, but in the future, there will be probably much progress in this direction. So shall we go towards personalized medicine? Probably, and if we go there, then microfluidic will play an important role. Organ on a chip. I am not a specialist, but this is the next step. In fact, this is an area that is very important in the domain of microfluidics. In fact, there is a program that leads to reproduce as much as possible on a chip a number of organs. The idea is that, in fact, when you try a therapeutic molecule on animals, it is said, I'm not a specialist, that 10% of the drugs that are successful in animal trials are ultimately successful, only 10% are ultimately successful in humans. So there is really a discrepancy. And the goal of producing organ on a chip is precisely to remove as much as possible such a discrepancy and working not on animals but on samples. And the organ on a chip technology has the potential to replace all these traditional approaches and to drug discovery and development. So it has this potential. Now, microfluidics has something to do with organ on a chip, because if you want to reproduce a lung, for instance, you have to make this lung functional and see whether a therapeutic molecule will affect the function of the lung. Then you have to drive a flow in this system, blood flow, air flow for the lung, and this deals with microfluidics. Microfluidic is extremely important in this area. So I think I will end with nanofluidics, and I will talk about the market. We wrote a review that was published recently with Lideric Bouquet to talk about nanofluidic, the physics and the technology of nanofluidics. In fact, for a long time, nanofluidic is a very interesting area. For a long time, it was thought that nanofluidic is the future of microfluidics. In fact, people were thinking that microfluidics, there is a sort of Moore law that leads microfluidic to go more and more towards miniaturization or ultra-miniaturization of the devices. So we were standing at the microscale, and the future is the nanoscale, according to Moore law. But in fact, there is no Moore law in microfluidics. And this vision was a bit superficial. There is no Moore law, and and there are some characteristic scales that are important to take into account to find interesting application or interesting use of microfluidic technology. If you take a cell, for instance, a eukaryotic cell, measure something like 10 micrometers, and it is clear that if you want to study the cell, you need a larger container, 100 micrometers. And nanofluidic is unable to provide this kind of container, obviously. But nanofluidics, so for some time also, nanofluidics was considered as related to silicon and glass technology, because people did not think that it was possible to use different materials. PDMS was not appropriate to perform studies of nanofluidic flows. But probably this is a mistake, because in the nature, you have nanofluidic systems that work very well that are not made in silicon nor in glass. This is the case of the kidney, for instance. This is a nanofluidic system. And also aquaporins. Aquaporin is a molecule that allows to exchange from across the membrane of the cell water. So you say it's just a molecule, so what? But macrofluidic, nanofluidic comes into play in the fact that the speed of exchange is extremely fast. If we take that as a standard channel and apply the standard law of hydrodynamic resistance, then you would find that the transfers are order of magnitude slower than they are in reality. So, in fact, the nature exploited the particular nanofluidic properties of nanofluidic flows, in particular, the possibility of driving a fluid in a very confined space at a large speed, taking into account the slippage property of the boundaries, and they exploited this property to make cells alive. So this is the environment of nanofluidic. In nanofluidics, you have specific law that you don't for which you don't find the equivalent in standard fluid dynamics. For instance, if you plot, you push water inside a carbon nanotube. Again, the flows that you can obtain are much larger than what we expect if we apply the standard law of hydrodynamics. This is due to the fact that on those scales, the water molecules do not flow as in a standard channel, but the molecules tend to move one behind the other. This is a particular structure of the flow. And on the other hand, the walls develop important slippage phenomena because in the carbon nanotube, the roughness is extremely small. And then if a wall, if a surface is hydrophobic and infinitely small, is infinitely smooth, then you have a huge slippage of water over the surface. In fact, this is like a free surface. But because of the atomic roughness, the slippage is not that large. And it turns out that the atomic roughness inside the carbon nanotube is really, really small, so you have large slippage phenomena. And these slippage phenomena are very interesting from the for the application. For instance, people have thought of making membranes that are based on the collection of many, many nanotubes. And this membrane, if it is possible to make them, people are working on that, there are companies that are working on that, then you would be able to filter water, for instance, at a very high efficiency, at a very high speed, as compared to standard membranes. And this can be useful for Hong Kong, because I learned that Hong Kong has not enough water, and Hong Kong has had to buy water from China. But if you have this type of membrane, you could desalt water sea and and save a lot of money. But perhaps this will happen in the future. Okay, there are new phenomena, and it was thought for a long time that the nanofluidic devices are too complicated to give rise to commercial applications. This is not true at all. In the field of gene sequencing, we have outstanding realization of nanofluidics device. For instance, this company, Oxford Nanopore, they have worked for 10 years on a system whose physical principle has been known for a long time. This is based on the fact that if you have a membrane and if you are able to make nanohole and force a DNA molecule to go through these holes, then if you measure the flow rate or the electrical potential, the hole is small enough to see the difference between the movement across the hole of a molecule and to distinguish between A, C, G, and T. So to sequence the DNA. They have strived for a long time, and one key issue was the control of all that, and they added a molecule, an enzyme here, that helps very much the control of the system. Now we have, so you could say, well, we are operating at the nanoscales, things are very delicate to control, so this would never give rise to any commercial system. But this is not true, because the Oxford nanopore system, this is nanopore mignon, this is the name of the system, allows to perform DNA sequencing using a USB card, USB key, that you plug on your computer to get the result. And as compared to the dominant technique that really is a leader, world leader in the field, based on, I would say, standard microfluidics. So in this machine, Illumina, you have thousands of microfluidic devices. As compared to that, you see that there's a reduction of time and also acceleration of speed. So nanofluidics really gives rise to outstanding and impressive realization. Let us go to microfluidic market to conclude. In fact, the microfluidic market is very diverse. This has been recognized 10 years ago, and because you have to face and solve many different problems. You have to face the complexity of matter, of living systems. It's not monolithic as in a computer. This is why the evolution of the market is completely different as compared to the microelectronic market, and this is why there is no Moore law. But you know, the size of this market is not big at the moment. $5 billion per year. It's not big at all. This is a sort of micro market. But the strategy of the lab is not to wait that this market gets big to start working in it. We have to start now at the time where the market is taking off. I would like to give you an example of the groundbreaking character of microfluidic technology. Let us take the example of discovery of enzymes. That is, which is a very big market, about a few billions of dollars per year. If you want to perform 50 million of tests with the present technique, you use robots, and these robots are doing what you could do, but 50 million of times, taking plates, using micro-titer plates and making some mixing in tubes. But you would need 5,000 liters of reagents. It would take 2 years and it would cost $5 million. If you use microfluidic droplet-based technology, it would use 150 microliters of reagent. It would take 7 hours and it would cost $2.30. So you have 6 orders of magnitude between this situation and that situation. Where does this come from? Just a reduction of volume. When you use a microtiter plate, then you use 100 of microliter in each tube. But you can do the same, exactly the same, using droplets, and each droplet is 100 picoliters in volume. So from microliter to picoliter, you have 6 orders of magnitude in volume of difference. It is like one bottle compared to a big swimming pool. And indeed, you earn a lot of reagents. And since the reagents are very expensive, you can decrease the price of the technique by 6 orders of magnitude. So you see that just by a volume reduction, you get a considerably important advantage going to microfluidic. So this is what is at the basis of many microfluidic applications, but not only that, other aspects of this technology come into play to allow the development of interesting application in the diagnostic, for instance, DNA sequencing, cosmetics, display. Kindle is a microfluidic device. And in the future, probably we will have all this in this part, all these systems. And I would say this is my last transparency. Is the review written in 2006 still pertinent? Yes. All the items that I presented here, except paper technology, except a few, are mentioned in the review by George Whiteside. But the emphasis is not the same as the one that we could give today if we had to write another review on microfluidics. But still, in this review, we still have not at a mature stage. Still in an early stage of development. Commercialization has been taken seriously over the last 10 years. That leads to a market of a few billions of dollars. And today, again, we have to develop creativity, imagination, ingenuity to make the field progress, because it's really an empty space where creativity is welcome. To finish, just a couple of words of the Institute. In fact, in France, we like this technology, and we have a new Institute that includes 15 teams, people that were recognized in the field, Lédéric Bocquet, Andrew Griffiths, Jean-Louis Viovi, and also people who are very well recognized in their own field, chemist, biology, for instance, Vincent Croquette, etc. These people include include 250 researchers. We have a building that hosts part of these 250 people, 6,000 meters square, right in the center of Paris. We have been supported by the government and the city of Paris, and recently we had the visit of the President of the Republic, who paid some attention to this operation. This is the President of the Republic, François Hollande. This is the mayor of Paris. This is the Ministry of the Research. And this guy, I don't know who he is. Perhaps he succeeded to move and go close to the president, but I don't know him. Perhaps he's famous. And this is the Degen picture that we put at the entry of the building. And Degen really is our source of inspiration. So I would like to thank you for coming here. And expressing some interest in microfluidics, and I hope that this overview will find some attraction for you. Thank you very much.
Okay, I have a question for this microfluidics. I agree that in general microfluidics didn't follow like Moore's law, right, to become, but in general, in my own study, we also find those DNA sequencing technology, they really six old negative price reduction, and so that now people actually also use this kind of semiconductor technology to make this a new type of DNA sequencing chip. So that, of course, from my point of view, is probably is a hybrid integration, maybe a way how we leverage this kind of material, right, like PDMS polymer with semiconductor material, silicon, something, hybrid integration will be maybe can facilitate this kind of development in the long term future. This is my own view. I don't know.
Yes, in fact, you are right. DNA sequencing follows a Moore law. Quite impressive, by the way, quite fast, very impressive. And I would say that microfluidic technology is associated to big fields that follow Moore law, but the technology itself is very diverse, and there is no Moore law that seems to appear out of the domain. We had discussion about that with Steve Quake precisely because he had these valves and he wanted to show that there is a Moore law,
That means that the density of valves will increase in time, and the number of valves also will increase in time. But so this law was working for the first 4 years of the development of Fluidigm, but then it saturated. And he said, so I asked him, well, there is no more law then. And he said, this is not because it saturates that it won't take off again. So globally, there can be a more law. But also, we may notice that since there is one single company in the world that is selling these valves, the price does not follow a more law at all. The price was 200K 10 years ago. It's still 200K. So I don't think, but I agree with you. That's but you know, in microelectronics, there is no characteristic scale because the scale related to the electron is really a quantum scale. But in microfluidics, the objects that we manipulate have a characteristic scale. So, but I agree, perhaps concerning the manipulation of DNA, we will tend to decrease and decrease the size. There will be a sort of specific more law for this application. This may happen. Yeah.
Any question or comment from students?
In your talk, there is an interesting example of a patient, a cancer patient, and you say that if you can isolate the cancer cell and analyze the mutation, but that cancer seems already metastasis to the all the body. So if in real case, that means that the cells, so how many cells can you
analyze? At the moment, the number is very low. It's something like 100. This is ridiculously. But precisely the goal of the technology at the moment is to increase this number up to 1 million, something like this. But I agree with you. For the picture here, perhaps it's too late. But if you start a study at the single cell level of cancer cells, then you may expect that the treatment will be more efficient. And you know, there is an intrinsic variability of the cell behavior that is not taken into account now. And microfluidic may help, will help in the future to take that into account, probably.
In your lecture, there is something about the point of care or personal diagnosis. But the chip is very small, but under most situations, you need something like syringes or a huge optical microscope to observe the result. So do you think it's possible for lab-on chip to finally overcome these bulky detectors and accessories and finally go to a really very, very small lab-on chip?
Yes, this is a very good point. What you say, what we often say, it's not a lab on a chip, but chip on the lab. People often say that. But to be specific, in fact, for the contagious disease, the challenge is really to go on field and to have a self, to have an autonomous system that would be based, for instance, on colorimetry rather than fluorescence detection. You know, the pregnancy test is an example because there is no pump because of capillarity and you do not need any equipment to. So this is really the model that people want to realize for the detection of Ebola or Zika or dengue. But it's much more complicated. This is a problem and there is an interesting technical challenge. At the moment, most of the techniques that are used in this field use an equipment somewhere. So it cannot go to the field. It can be used in local clinics, local hospital. It's not that bad. But the steps to
to go to cross is precisely to be completely autonomous. And this is an interesting challenge. The problem is that this domain needs money. But the money at the moment, if you look at market studies, is essentially given by donators, like big gets. Big companies don't make money if the system is too cheap. So as long as it will stay like this, it will be difficult to make progress and go to there. So it's a moral issue, by the way. Why don't we spend more money to do that? But at the moment, so companies, startups like the one initiated by George Whiteside has difficulty, got some money from $10 million from Bill Gates, but he has a device that is close to be used, but still there are some issues, but close to be used on the field, but it doesn't have anyone to develop this device, commercialize and industrialize it. Well.
So. Okay, I think I also add some comment on this one. In general, I think microfluid research in the stage are probably similar to the semiconductor research in IT, 50, 60, 70, and then so that we do need to spend a lot more effort on the design, right? How to come with a good design of different toolbox, right? In microfluidics, so that once you have a very good idea about design of each key component, micromixer, or some immunoassay and detection, and then we think about how we do the integration. Like now for computer in like 50 years, 60 years ago, and then gradually really take time to do the integration. Now your smartphone is an example. Right? It's a really like supercomputer, but really take time to do a lot, spend a lot of time and effort, right? Money to do research, and then gradually can do all the integration. Yeah, so this is really take time, but that's why I encourage some students, if you really want to, you can go this area. So this is gradually, it becomes bigger and bigger. Right, like when I study PhD at UCLA in MEMS, that time with no product or MEMS sensor, but now every smartphone about more than 10 MEMS sensor. Hopefully in the future, all the microfluid devices will be equipped with your smartphone for healthcare or medical diagnosis. And I think this is an ongoing project. You can see some of research going on try to integrate the microfluid with smartphone.
Yes, that's true. There are at the moment something like 400 or 500 startups in microfluidics. So we will have popping up a lot of products.
Right. That means a lot of future. If you want to make money and go this year, probably you can be the next Bill Gates. Okay, any other question? No more? Okay, so if no more question, we probably can thank Professor Patrick again. Okay.